Hello, my name is John, and today we're in cockpit of the Mirage 2000 again. And in this video, I will take a small peek at the radar of the aircraft. We will not go into the full depth of the radar, as the radar system is not fully modeled as of yet, and also the documentation is lacking a lot of information, so we will hold off with that to a later point once both of the stuff is available. Anyway, let's get started. First off, I guess you already noticed it if you have been flying the Mirage. We have the radar screen down here, and we can turn that on with a switch down at the bottom right. And let's talk about the stuff we immediately see. We have the TDC up here, which shows you us the angle left and right in degrees. So for example, 11.5 degrees to the right, and or 29 degrees to the right, and the distance, like currently 6 nautical miles or 5.9 nautical miles away, and 7.8 and stuff like that, which is very handy to measure out the distance and bearing to a target, obviously, and can be very useful, especially when you have multiple wingmen. Continuing with the switches on the radar, we have the intercept switch, which allows you to get the intercept guidance. I couldn't find that on the manual as of yet, so I'm not sure if it's working or not. I will check that for a later video though. Then we have some optional mode selectors that we can use to with context menus that will appear on the side, but I do believe that's not implemented as well. Then down here in the middle we have some brightness settings which we can not use as well, unfortunately. And behind the control stick, if I move that out of the place, we have a declutter and a display ground map option, which are both for the ground mapping possibility of the radar, which we will not be looking at in this video though. On the radar screen itself, we have a status information about the radar, currently showing that the radar is off. Then we have the heading tape, showing us our current heading. We have our own altitude, which is 19,900 feet. We have our own airspeed in knots and Mach, and we have some more information depending on the radar mode, which we will take a look at in a second. Behind the throttle, we have the main radar control panel, and starting from the top here, at least with the stuff that's already working, we have the main mode selector switch, and if we click that once, we can get the radar into the P mode, and that's warming up, allowing the radar to heat up to its operating temperature. Continuing, we have the SIL mode, and the SIL mode is basically a standby mode. Radar is not emitting anything, but would be ready for operation at this point. And if we continue once more, we have the emission mode, where the radar is actually emitting data. There is no letter here, but you can see it with, or you can see that it's working by the small line up there, showing us where the radar is looking currently. And now you also see the lines on the radar, and if I move the TDC left and right, you can see it moves in an arc, because now the display is displaying stuff in an arc, and you will notice the distance is constant at 7.8 nautical miles. However, moving it left and right will just move it in the arc, and a target being at this point and a target being at this point will have the same distance to each other, or distance of, from me to them. And this is a normal display mode for this type of radar. However, if you're more used to the American radar type, where it's displayed in a square, we can switch to the B mode up here. And now you can see if I move it left and right, it will move left and right. And this shows us a distorted view, so it's not a circle anymore, but this can be useful if you want, if you have a target here and here, you can immediately see how far or which one is closer and stuff like that. So it might be helpful, and especially if you're used to the American system. However, for purpose of this video, we'll switch back to the PPI mode. Okay, continuing with stuff which is very useful. Down here in the bottom right is the distance selector, and we can increase the radar scan distance up to 18 nautical miles, and up here it currently shows the maximum distance is 20 nautical miles. We can increase and decrease that to our liking. Another important selector is this one up here, and that's the azimuth selector, or the horizontal scan zone selector, and currently it's 60 degrees, or to be more specific at plus minus 60 degrees, so it scans in 60 degrees in either direction, giving us a total scan zone of 120 degrees. If we put that to 30 degrees, you can see the radar is moving faster now, because it has only to scan 60 degrees totally, and is scanning at twice the speed. However, the scan zone is smaller. If we move it once more, we get a 30 degree scan zone, and the radar is moving very fast now. However, we can only see targets that are pretty much directly in front of us. The most useful mode, especially if you don't know where the target is, I guess, would be the 60 plus minus 60 mode, giving us 120 degrees, giving us easy option to find the target. And the last most important switch we have here is the line selector, which we can select between 4, 2 and 1. And what this does, we have to take a bit more look on the radar itself. And the radar dish itself is scanning 3 degrees. It can scan 3 degrees horizontally and 3 degrees vertically. And you get the full 120 degree scan zone by moving the radar left and right over that arc. However, the horizontal scan zone is not moving if you're in the line 1 mode. And in the line 1 mode, the radar is just moving left and right on a level pattern. And this only gives you a 3 degree high scan zone, but it's very fast. However, not very helpful, obviously, because only scanning 3 degrees where 1.5 degrees are above you and 1.5 degrees are below you is very small and narrow. So we can go to the lines 2 mode, and this will cause the radar to sweep in an up and down pattern. It will sweep the upper 3 degrees and the lower 3 degrees, giving us a total of 6 degrees, 3 above and 3 below the horizon. And if you continue to 4 lines mode, we get 2 lines above horizon and 2 lines below horizon, giving us a total of 12 degrees of radar scan. And however, the problem there is that the radar takes now 4 sweeps to scan the whole altitude sector. So if you move the radar or something like that, you have to wait 4 sweeps until you get the full information, and the target data will only be refreshed every 4th sweep. And yeah, I hope that makes sense in this regard. And I would now like to continue on to a practical example where we'll try to look at a couple of different targets. Okay, continuing onwards from here, we have a couple of targets ahead of us, and I will increase the radar distance to, let's go 40 miles. And we can already see two targets on the radar scope up here. And the only information we get here by default is that the target has a relative speed to us of 0.8 Mach. And that's not very helpful. Let's increase the radar scans on one further, so we can see the other two targets as well. Yeah, we have now, we can see we're having the radar scans on it, our full 80 nautical miles. We can see one target, the closest one to us, is closing or has a relative speed of 0.7 Mach, the other one has 0.3 Mach, and the last one has 0.8 Mach. So and one target just disappeared out of our radar because it's at a different altitude, probably. Anyway, we can move the TDC over a target, and then we can lock it, and I recommend to bind those to your joystick so you have them on hand. Anyway, we will lock the closest target. Okay, and now what we get is the point, track while scan mode, as you would call it in an American aircraft. And you notice the other target is still visible, and this target is highlighted, but is not exclusively locked. And this allows us to get us some more data on the aircraft. Up here we get the altitude of the target, which is 20,000 feet, and we get the relative speed, which would be 406 nautical miles relative to us, because it's beaming us, it's reducing. Okay, that's quite handy. And we also get the information up here. This is information up here, is the target's heading. As you can see, the target is moving from left to right, and at a heading of about 68 degrees. Just for comparison, let's lock the other target. Or unlock first, and then let's lock the other target, sorry. If it wants to, yeah, there we go. Yeah, you can see this target is moving at a heading of 186 degrees. And we have the speed vector up here. And we also see it's closing in at 627 nautical miles, and it's an altitude of 24,600 feet. And we currently lost the other aircraft of our scope, probably because it moved out of our scan zone. Anyway, after you have track while scanned a target like this, you have to lock it a second time to get a single track lock, which would be something similar to, or what would you need to engage a target. And now, after locking it a second time, we will not be able to see any more target data. There is there won't be any other targets appearing on our display. We have all our radar energy going to that target, and that target will get a launch warning or a lock warning tone respectively. And this mode is necessary to engage targets. And as for the Mirage, there are no missiles that can engage in track while scan, so you have to have a solid lock on the target. Anyway, let me unlock the target once more. And let me see if we can scan all three targets. Okay, we have the first target here. And currently the radar is not picking up the other targets, interestingly enough. I'm not sure what they did. I have been recording for a while. Some of them might have RTB'd. Oh no, there's a second target, and somewhere should be our third target. And let me just lock the other target as well. Okay, and you can again see we got the speed vector for that. We got the heading of it and the relative speed. Anyway, that should conclude our radar overview, our very basic radar overview. We will get more detailed in a later video, and I will hold off with that until more data is available and all the systems are working as they be, or as they should be. Because else I don't think it makes sense, or it doesn't make too much sense. We will also talk about the HUD symbology in another video, I guess. Or at least I didn't do that in this video, I don't want to make it too long. We can have a very quick look though, if you want, I guess. And I guess the stuff that's really necessary here is the square box, showing us where the target is relative to us, and the closing speed, the distance, which would be 31 nautical miles. And yeah, that's all what I want to cover for this video. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you liked it, and I hope I can get you more videos over this coming weekend. So I hope you're looking forward to that, and fly safe.